Hello students, I am Geeta Saranathan. I welcome you to my chemistry class meant for helping you in the preparation of SAT Chemistry 2 examination. This session is on Chapter 1, Atoms and Molecules. Substances in nature can be basically classified into elements, compounds and mixtures. Elements are the simplest particles, simplest substances in nature. As examples for elements, I can give carbon, oxygen, sulfur, aluminium, etc. As compounds, we find water, carbon dioxide, and many more. Compounds contain two or more elements. As you find here, water contains the elements hydrogen and oxygen, and carbon dioxide contains elements carbon and oxygen. Mixtures contain two or more elements or compounds. The simplest and most common example of mixture is air, which is a mixture of so many gases. And again, if you take a spoon of salt and put it in water, you get a mixture of salt solution, which contains salt and water. Now, let us come back to elements. If you take a piece of carbon and go on dividing it until you reach a particle which cannot divide further, we say you have got an atom of carbon. This atom of carbon possesses all the properties of carbon. So, an atom can be defined as the tiniest particle of an element, and then it possesses all the properties of the element. Tiniest particle possessing all the properties of the element. Now, the simplest or the tiniest particles of compounds are called molecules. If you take one molecule of water, it contains two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen. Similarly, a molecule of carbon dioxide contains one atom of carbon and two atoms of oxygen. There are so many compounds which contain two or more elements, or even four or five elements, etc. Coming back to atom, initially it was thought that atoms cannot be divided further. That is what Dalton proposed in his atomic theory. He said atoms cannot be broken down to simpler particles. But the scientists who came later found subatomic particles like electron, proton and neutron inside the atom. They not only discovered the particles, they also determined their mass and charges. Now, you find in the table on the screen all details regarding these three subatomic particles. Electrons have a symbol E and they have a relative mass of 0. They carry a charge of -1 unit. Protons are represented as P. They carry a mass of 1 AMU, that is 1 atomic mass unit. That is the relative simple way of expressing their mass, and they carry a charge of +1. Neutrons are depicted as N. They carry a mass of, they have a mass of 1 atomic mass unit, and they are having no charge. You find that protons and neutrons have the same mass. Electrons having a charge of -1, protons are having a charge of +1, and neutrons have no charge. In the last two columns, I have given you the absolute mass and absolute charge of these particles, which we don't have to take up for consideration at this moment. After gaining knowledge about the subatomic particles, the next step was to find out how these are arranged inside an atom. Rutherford's gold foil experiment was a big leap in this regard. He bombarded a thin gold foil with alpha particles. Alpha particles are particles with 2 units of positive charge and 4 units of mass. Charge is plus 2 and mass is 4 units. And why did he choose a gold foil? Because it is a metal which is most ductile. That is, you can get the thinnest sheets with only gold metal. So he took a very thin sheet of gold metal which contains gold atoms, and he hit them with alpha particles from a radioactive source. He found that most of the particles passed through, that is, the gold atoms did not offer any resistance to these alpha particles and allowed them to pass through. Some of them, a few of them, were deflected like this. You can see these were deflected, and a very small fraction was they allowed to retrace the path, that is, they were sent right back. From this experiment, he made the following conclusions. He said most of the space inside an atom is empty because the alpha particles pass through without facing any resistance from the gold atoms. An atom has a highly dense core of positive charge and mass called the nucleus. The alpha particles which are hitting the peripheral part of the nucleus were deflected, and a very small fraction of the alpha particles which are meeting this nuclei head on were sent right back. Then he said electrons revolve around the nucleus in circular paths called orbits. The credit for the discovery of nucleus is given to Rutherford, but he could not offer a very good explanation about the arrangement of electrons around the nucleus. His work was continued by Niels Bohr, and the arrangement of electrons in an atom around the nucleus is called electronic configuration, which we will take up for discussion in detail in a later chapter. An atom of an element is represented in a specific way. For example, carbon atom is represented as C612. 6 is called its atomic number, and 12 is called its atomic mass or mass number. Now, atomic number gives you the number of protons in an atom. You know, protons carry positive charge and atoms are neutral. So for the number of protons, you should have equal number of electrons. So this is also equal to number of electrons in an atom. So atomic number stands for number of protons, which is again equal to the number of electrons in an atom. Mass number is equal to number of protons plus number of neutrons. You know, protons and neutrons have mass. Electrons do not contribute to the mass of an atom. So mass number is given by number of protons and number of neutrons. Now we can say for this element carbon, number of atomic number is equal to number of protons is equal to number of electrons, that is equal to 6. And from this mass number, we can find out number of neutrons. So we can say number of neutrons is equal to mass number minus atomic number. Mass number minus atomic number, that is equal to 12 minus 6, that is equal to 6 here. Is that clear? So if you are given the representation of an element, you will be able to find out the number of protons, electrons and neutrons in an atom. I will give you one more. Sodium atom is represented as Na11-23. So what is the number of protons in this atomic number? This one, the one on the lower side, gives you the number of protons and also the number of electrons. So we can say number of protons, P. P is equal to 11 and number of electrons is equal to 11 and number of neutrons is equal to 12. 23 minus 11, that is equal to 12. I suppose it is clear to you. You often find elements with atomic weights which are not whole numbers. For example, in the periodic table, you may see that magnesium is represented as Mg12 24.3 and calcium is represented as Ca20 40.48. These are not whole numbers. Just now we saw that number of neutrons is given by atomic mass minus atomic number. So can we say magnesium has 12.3 neutrons and calcium has 20.48 neutrons? That's not possible, isn't it? Then how do we explain this? Fractional atomic masses. To explain this, I have to introduce the concept of isotopes to you now. What are isotopes? Elements exist in different isotopes. I'll tell you now. For example, carbon exists in two forms, C6-12 and C6-14. These two are called isotopes. You find that these two have the same atomic number but different atomic masses. That means they have the same number of protons and electrons but have different number of neutrons. The C614 is called the radioactive carbon, and you may be aware that radiocarbon is used for dating objects from archaeological excavations. But you know, these are not present to the same extent in nature or environment. For example, if you take chlorine, it exists as Cl1735 and Cl1737 in the ratio 75:25 in nature. So when we calculate the actual atomic mass of chlorine, we have to take into account the two different isotopes and also the extent to which these are present in nature. If you take a sample of 100 atoms of chlorine, you will find that 75 atoms have an atomic mass of 35 and 25 atoms have an atomic mass of 37. So you calculate the atomic mass of chlorine this way. 75 into 35 plus 25 into 37 divided by 100, you will get the atomic mass of chlorine as 35.5. That is why you find chlorine represented as Cl1735.5. I suppose now you get an idea of how elements get their fractional atomic masses. I have given you the definition of isotopes here. Isotopes are atoms of the same element having the same atomic number but different atomic mass, or those having same number of protons or electrons but different number of neutrons. Now look at these two atoms. They have different atomic number but same atomic mass. Are these isotopes? You very well know that these are not, because you know that isotopes have same atomic number. These are in fact carbon 6-14 and nitrogen 7-14. These two atoms have different atomic numbers but same mass numbers. So these are called isobars. So what are isobars? They are atoms of different elements which have different atomic numbers but same mass number. Once again I tell you, C6-12 and C614 are isotopes because they are atoms of same element. C614 and N714 are isobars. They are atoms of different element. different elements. From this one important idea, we learned that atomic number is the identity of an element. Identity of an element. So when I give you an element X, 20, 40, to find out what element it is, you have to see with which atomic number, with which element this atomic number tallies. So from the atomic number only you find out the element and not the mass number. So the atomic number 20 belongs to calcium. You say the element is calcium. I suppose it is clear to you. Now you know that the number of protons in an atom is equal to number of electrons. For example, this Na1123 has 11 protons and 11 electrons. Let us see what happens when we add an electron or remove an electron from an atom. If you remove an electron from the sodium atom, it will have 11 protons and 10 electrons. That means it will have 11 positive charge and 10 negative charge. So the net result will be the sodium atom will have one extra positive charge. It will be represented as Na plus. Now this is called a sodium ion. Ion should not be represented with the atomic number at atomic mass. It should be represented only this way, showing the number of charges on the right side top of the atom. So Na plus stands for sodium ion. Let us consider adding two electrons to oxygen, which is 0, 8, 16. It has 8 protons and 8 electrons. Now if you add 2 electrons to this oxygen atom, it will have 8 protons and 10 electrons. That is 2 excess negative charge over positive charge. Now this will be represented as O2-. This is the oxide ion. O2- stands for the oxide ion and Na plus stands for the sodium ion. Having learnt this, I have summed up the ideas that we discussed so far. The main ideas that we discussed have been summed up here. You can go through this recap, which will be followed by an exercise. That is, I will be discussing the type of questions that you will be facing in the examination on this chapter. You will have 3 types of questions in the test. In type A, you will be given 2 sets, one letter, the other one number. For the numbered statements, you will have to pick one from the lettered choices. Each one of the lettered choices can be used once or more than once, or sometimes need not be used at all. I will do the first two for you. First statement is, will be different in isotopes. You know the definition of isotopes. Then, you know, isotopes have the same atomic number and they differ in atomic masses. So the choice will be E. Second statement is, has almost entire mass of an atom. Obviously, it is the nucleus and so it is choice D. So same way, you can attempt the other questions. I have numbered them 1 to 4 in each set. Actually, each one will be a different question. You can count it as 8 different questions in the actual test. In type B, you are given 2 statements, 1 and 2. Go through the statements and find out if these are true or false. And then under appropriate places, you can color the space. If the first statement is true, then under 1, you can color T there. In the same way, you can do for the second statement. And then you find a word because there. If the second statement is the reason for the first one, then because becomes meaningful there. So you can color that space under CE. If the second statement is not the reason for the first one, you can leave it as it is. I will do the first one for you here. Most of the elements have atomic masses which are not whole numbers. You know it is true. So you can color the space T under 1 and leave false blank. Same way, electrons revolve around the nucleus in orbits, which is true again. You can fill the space true under 2. You know second statement is not the reason for the first one. So we will leave CE blank here. I suppose you have learnt. You can attempt the other question. Type C is the usual multiple choice type of question. There is an incomplete statement on top. Complete it choosing any one of the given choices below. Among these two questions, the first one is to convert nitrogen to N3- you have 2. And then there are 5 choices below. You know N3- carries 3 negative charges in excess over the neutral nitrogen atom. So 3 negative charges are equivalent to adding 3 electrons. So the choice D will be the correct one. Add 3 electrons to nitrogen. You can attempt the second question. I have given the answers here. You can verify your answers with what is given here. You don't need any explanation because the questions are very simple based on facts. Thanks for listening to my class. Hope it was useful to you.